everybody. Yeah. We're now at the Harmony of Gospels, part 28. I took a look at what's left to do, and it looks like I'm only about a third of the way. Third of the way. Well, that might be another year and a half then, or so. Before I get into that, though, I want to ask, how many do daily Bible readings?
Not daily, but throughout the week.
Throughout the week is good. Daily is better, right? God wants us to search His Word and be familiar with His Word and just be with Him every day, not just part of the week. And because it's January, you know. See this here? This one's called the One-Year Bible. It's the New Living Translation, which is modern English. That it's very easy to read. Sometimes the translation's a little iffy. But I really like it because it breaks it down January 1, January 2, January 3, all the way to December 31. Right? And it doesn't take much reading at all. I mean, it takes me maybe 10 minutes a day to do it. And January 1 starts with Genesis. Then it goes into Matthew, and then it has a bit of Psalms and a bit of Proverbs. So it's not just reading from Genesis all the way to Revelation throughout. It breaks it up. Right, you get a bit of the Old Testament, you get a bit of the New Testament, you get a bit of Psalms, you get a bit of Proverbs every day. And when I do this, and I make sure that I do it every day, right, it's surprising just how much closer you are every day to God, right? If you don't partake in the Word of God on a daily basis, you tend to start drifting easier, right? When you make it your daily task, daily, you know, it's not a task, actually. I look forward to reading it. You know? It doesn't take much at all. I just wanted to point this out. I mean, this is a very easy way to do it, rather than just trying to find, okay, I'll read some of John today, or, you know. Now, I've tried to read the Bible through cover to cover from Genesis all the way through to Revelation, and it's hard to do it that way. It is. You know, some people like doing it that way, and they're very successful at it. But that's a suggestion to make it easier and fun, actually. And it's only January 17. You know, people out there want to give that a shot. You know, I highly encourage that. I just wanted to share that because, you know, it's the new year again, and I'm getting re-into it. And I just wanted to share what I do.
Don't you find that there's something else going on too?
Elaborate.
Daily, when I'm confronted with a human situation, or someone's done something against me, or some pressure has hit. Constantly have a mental image of Scripture in my mind that helps me cope with that.
Absolutely, it does.
I suppose when you're driving,
yep,
you're looking at the sky or whatever, something there that prompts you to think of God.
If you're in a constant daily communication with God, you know, best way is to read the Scriptures, and the other way is to actually be in prayer. When you do it,
write them on your innermost part.
Absolutely,
and you can feel that.
Doing it on a daily basis, you are so much better able to cope with the daily trials of the world, right? And you have to actually do it to experience it and understand what I'm saying. If you've never actually done it like that, then you don't really get it, right? There's nothing like experience, right? Hearing something about something without actually doing it is not the same thing at all.
What can you do?
Every day, right? And it's just my suggestion to make it easy and enjoyable, right? Especially when you get, I mean, who likes reading through Numbers? Numbers is tough, you know? Reading through Job is tough, too. Job is a great book. It's a tough one, right? But if you're reading a part of Job, and then you go and you're reading maybe part of Mark, and then you read some Psalms and some Proverbs, It breaks it up and it makes it much more easy.
Where'd you buy that arrow?
It was at Hall's?
Not
downtown?
Not really expensive either, I bet.
Oh, heck no. That was cheap. Cheap
that's
like dirt.
Probably on the vine.
I don't think so, but maybe, yeah. Oh yeah, $14.50.
Yeah.
This costs $14.50. There's many different kinds of one-year Bibles. You can find them. Yeah, some places. Many different kinds of one-year Bibles. Some are like all different translations too. So, just a suggestion. It's very easy. I like this one because it gives it a nice modern English translation. Like, I just opened it up here, I'll read. Finally, I brought you into the land of the Amorites on the east side of the Jordan. They fought against you, but I gave you victory over them, and you took possession of their land. I mean, it's easy reading. Easy reading. Right?
I didn't hear any thee or thou or
thoust. No. Because if you're reading King James like that on a daily basis, it's hard. It's hard sometimes, especially when you get into, some scriptures, like Job, for instance.
He that pisseth against the fence.
Yeah, it's kind of tough.
It's kind of a weird translation.
It's kind of tough. Well, let's continue into the harmony of the Gospels. Now we've got that aside. John 7, verse 1. We're only going to do one verse of John 7. This was immediately after he just gave his Bread of Life sermon. That was a good one last week. After these things, Jesus was sojourning in Galilee, for he did not desire to travel in Judea, because the Jews were seeking to kill him. No kidding. After that last sermon that he gave to them, he wasn't really welcome among the Jewish leadership. Not at all. We'll go to Mark 7. Mark 7. Beginning in verse 1. Then the Pharisees and some of the scribes from Jerusalem, he's not in Jerusalem anymore, from Jerusalem came together to him. And the other book we'll be reading from is Matthew. Matthew 15. So we'll keep a finger in Mark 7 and Matthew 15. Matthew 15, verse 1 also says, then the scribes and Pharisees from Jerusalem came to Jesus saying. Now, before we get into what they were asking in this conversation, why were the Pharisees and scribes still present around Jesus? After all these confrontations, after all these disagreements, especially since they wanted to kill him, why were the Pharisees and scribes still around him? Do you think they worried about him? Feared him? The Jewish leaders would now follow him about wherever he went, wherever he would go. But they were hostile to him. They weren't just inquiring with the purpose of learning anything. They were hostile to him, openly so. They were criticizing him. They were looking for every opportunity to criticize him now. Wherever he would go, and at any moment in time that they could, they were watching him closely, they were listening to what he said, trying to find some way to openly criticize him. They were trying to find a fault with him or with his disciples in an attempt to discredit him. They needed to discredit him openly, especially in front of the multitudes and the crowds and the masses. They feared the masses. The masses were where they got their power from. And Jesus and his disciples, they were getting quite the following. People were listening to them, especially Jesus himself. And the things that Jesus was saying were flying in the face of what the Jewish leadership had always been saying. So they couldn't just leave him alone. They couldn't leave him alone. Their intentions were evil continuously from then on, as they desired to kill him even more. Can you imagine? Put yourself in that place. Like today, for instance. Can you imagine what that would have been like? Or what would that be like today? Say that you're just, you know, on your daily basis, you're doing what you can do to do God's will on a daily basis, but you're constantly being dogged, not just by anybody, but by the recognized leaders of the church today, who hate you. And their sole purpose is to criticize you with the intent to discredit you. Right? And we're talking about the leaders of the known church today, constantly dogging you on a daily basis, trying to criticize you, trying to discredit you, and ultimately they want to kill you. How would you be able to cope on a daily basis with that? This is what Jesus had to deal with on a daily basis. How can we possibly complain about our, in comparison, daily trials? Right? And they were living during the Roman times, Roman occupation. And we know how brutal the Romans were. And we knew that the Jewish leadership couldn't kill Jesus by himself or by themselves. You know, they didn't have really a way to do it. Well, they would depend on the Romans to do that. And we all know how the Romans killed. It wasn't very easy. Death, you know, with the Romans. And Jesus knew this. Right? And he knew that whenever he had to have a confrontation with these leaders that were dogging him every day, it was a provocation again, more and more. And he knew. I mean, how can you do that? Put yourself in that position on a daily basis, knowing, you know, the more you provoke these guys, the more your certain death is assured, and a horrible one at that. It's amazing what he did, isn't it? When you think of it in that way. With that kind of pressure. And he never went against God's will in the face of all of that. His disciples never got that kind of faith and determination and ability to withstand this kind of pressure until after the resurrection of Christ. Think about that when you go through your daily struggles, whatever they may be. Right? Your struggles in comparison today aren't that difficult. You can overcome whatever it is. You know? One day you may have to endure something far worse. Hopefully that doesn't happen. But it could. Hey, Mark 7, verse 2. And when they saw some of his disciples eating with defiled hands. I wanted to read Matthew 15, verse 2 first. Because Mark is a little bit more expounded. Matthew 15, verse 2. Why do your disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat bread. A simple statement. Mark gets a little bit more detailed. Mark 7, verse 2, and when they saw some of his disciples eating with defiled hands, that is, with unwashed hands, they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, holding fast to the tradition of the elders, do not eat unless they wash their hands thoroughly. Even when coming from the market, they do not eat unless they first wash themselves. And there are many other things that they have received to observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and brass utensils and tables. For this reason, the Pharisees and the scribes questioned him, saying, "Why don't your disciples walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands. We're going to explore this tradition of the elders just a little bit. Right? What is the tradition of the elders?
We must know.
The tradition of the elders. What is that? The tradition of the elders. We all know this, right? The oral law, right? Who was one of the best at keeping the tradition of the elders?
The Pharisees.
Yeah. Who was one of the very best?
Paul.
Ah, there we go, Paul. Let's see what Paul says about that. It's in Galatians 1, verse 14. Where are we here? Galatians 1 and verse 14. This is Paul saying, "And I was advancing in Judaism far beyond many of my contemporaries, in my own nation, being more abundantly zealous for the traditions of my fathers." Paul himself probably was one of the very best at keeping these traditions. There may not have been anybody who surpassed him in that. He was certainly zealous about keeping it. How did they consider their traditions in comparison to the scriptures?
They worried more about their traditions than...
Worried more about them, yes. It's not quite the right saying, but it's along the right line.
They put them first.
Put them first. We'll see just how much they put them first, just how deeply they considered them more important even. But what specifically is the oral law? Or their traditions. There's an example here where they have to wash their hands before they eat. Why would they have to wash their hands before they eat? Ceremonial cleanliness, yes. Why? What was the purpose beyond ceremonial cleanliness? How could they be ceremonially unclean? They viewed themselves as a very special people, and they were, because they were separated. They were, you know, God's special people, Israel, but just part. There was more than just the Jewish people, and all of Israel. They were sanctified, which is set apart. They knew that. They took it to an extreme, though, because they saw themselves as special and set apart, sanctified by God, that anybody that was not was unclean, and any contact with anybody who was unclean would make them unclean, ceremonially unclean, especially if they went to the market, because in the marketplace you would sometimes encounter people that were Gentiles, or heaven forbid, a Samaritan, right? They really looked down upon them. So they made it necessary, absolutely necessary, that you make sure that even before you eat anything, that you are ceremonially clean, that anything that could possibly have defiled you outwardly has been cleansed before you partake of anything like that. How extreme is that? And that's just one example. One example. There's many other things. But the oral law is much greater than that, than these ceremonial things of washing this and that to be clean. The oral law, in its entirety, is an accumulation of the wisdom handed down through the generations. The wisdom. It's an interesting word for this. In other words, it's the judgmental decisions right, that they've made throughout their generations, throughout their history, over matters of the written law. Precedents, if you would. We have a law, no, not a law, but the laws of our land, which are spelled out, right? And then you have the judicial system, which is trying to enforce those laws. And you have people called judges who have to make decisions based on the wording of the law. And they make judgment calls, which lead to things called precedents, which lawyers can call upon for other cases to make decisions as well. And you add on to that, and continuously, and if you go one generation to another, hundreds of generations, how many traditions or judgmental decisions are now made based on what the written word was, the written law? It's quite a bit, isn't there? It's quite a bit. And they revered this oral law, these traditions, because it was an accumulation of their wisdom over the generations, of the decisions that they've made based on the law of Moses. So you can see how important this was to them. And somebody trampling all over that, it makes sense that they would take great offense to it, wouldn't they? Who is this guy? In the beginning, these intentions, not in the beginning, you know, of creation, in the beginning when they started keeping these traditions, there was good intentions. It's good intentions, right? You make a judgment call on a matter concerning the law, and it looks like a good decision. You can use that as a basis to make another decision when a certain matter comes again, right? But over many generations, you can see how it could probably get skewed a little bit, and you saw how it has in the way that they have to be ceremonially clean before they eat anything. That was totally taken to an extreme. Totally taken to an extreme. The intentions, the good intentions, became bad. But they didn't recognize them as such. They looked at the oral law as a fence that surrounded and protected the law of Moses. Over time, these interpretations and decisions over matters of the written law became more important than the law that they were supposed to be protecting. This made the original intent of the written law not only confusing, but in many cases, lost altogether. They totally didn't get the intent of the original written law. These traditions led to an avoidance of outward defilement, right? An avoidance of outward defilement, which, when you'd practice the way the Pharisees did, could easily conceal inward defilement, because you appear righteous, but inwardly your house is filthy. They led to the entire nature of the understanding of sin and personal holiness to become so distorted that it was not understood anymore. Too much obsessive concern for outward cleanliness and very little concern for inward cleanliness. They saw themselves as separate. They separated themselves. I am a chosen one. I am special to God. And you are unclean. That led to great pride in oneself, belittlement and disdain of others. What traditions do we cling to today? There's lots of traditions in the churches of God. There's many large churches, that think they're the true churches, right? And they have huge followings, countless millions, and they have all kinds of ceremony and pageantry, which is actually more important than the scripture itself. Mark 7, verse 6. And Jesus answered and said to them, "Well did Isaiah prophesy concerning you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me.'" That's Isaiah 29:13. If you want to write that down. Can you see why Jesus called them hypocrites? Were they aware that they were hypocrites? In their minds, their oral traditions were more important. They were trying to protect themselves. They were trying to protect the people, the masses. They were, in their minds, doing good for God. Are we hypocrites? Hopefully not. Sometimes we may fall into that category. We need to repent of that. Can you also see how their hearts could be far from God? And where is our own heart? Why were they hypocrites? They considered their own traditions much more important than the Word of God. They forgot the Word of God. They laid aside the Word of God. They rejected the Word of God. And yet they thought they were following the Word of God. And they were teaching these things to others. And yet they thought they were righteous. And they were not righteous at all. They thought they were better than everyone else. And they were some of the worst. Matthew 15, verse 3. Jesus answered and said to them, "Why do you also transgress the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition?" That's being hypocritical there. Why do you also transgress the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition? Mark 7, verse 7. "But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men." In vain. Their worship via their traditions and not the true commandments and intentions of the law is vain. These traditions do not usurp the Word of God, and yet they hold them in more reverence. "For leaving the commandment of God, you hold fast the tradition of men, such as the washing of pots and cups, and you practice many other things like this." Then he said to them, "Full well do you reject the commandment of God, so that you may observe your own tradition." They truly did not understand the intent of the written law. They truly didn't. The intent was lost on them. That truth was lost to them. How long was that truth lost to them and their fathers before them? How many generations did it go back? Again, we'll review here. After the Babylonian exile, the Jewish rabbis made meticulous rules and regulations for the governance of daily life, which they call the oral law, or their traditions. They were initially intended for obeying strict interpretations and applications of the law of Moses. They were in oral form. They were handed down from generation to generation until finally put into writing in what's known as the Mishnah, around 200 AD by this rabbi called Judah Hanazi. Never heard of him before until I had to do this study. And this Mishnah forms the basic part of what's now known as the Talmud. There's a rabbi known as Eliezer. And he is known as one of the great teachers of the period of the Mishnah. He was also referred to as Rabbi Eleazar the Great. That's how much this man was revered. Rabbi Eleazar said, this is what he said, "He who expounds the scriptures in opposition to the tradition has no share in the world to come." Did you catch that? Say it again. And this was from a guy, very well-known fellow. They called him Rabbi Eleazar, or Eleazar the Great. I'm not trying to belittle him here. He's looked upon and revered as one of the great scholars. He said, "He who expounds the scriptures in opposition to the tradition has no share in the world to come." The Mishnah itself, which forms the basis of the Talmud, the Mishnah itself says, "It is a greater offense to teach anything contrary to the voice of the rabbis than to contradict Scripture itself." It's a greater offense to go against the traditions. Isn't that a wow moment? Mm-hmm. It's no wonder there are so few Jewish converts to Christianity. There's a big resistance to that. Let's apply that to Christianity, though. Same kind of thinking applies. Think also of today's modern Christianity. Indeed, Christianity since after the time of the apostles. Can you think of any churches that hold their own traditions in greater reverence than the scriptures? Oh, yeah. I'm not going to single out and name different organizations. We're all smarter than that. You don't have to be pointing fingers. We know. Is there a danger for the churches of God to do that too? If you cannot find it in here, in the scriptures, then it's not important. If you hold something else, your own private interpretation of this, you better watch out. Anyone who adds to it or takes away from it is in danger. Mark 7, verse 10. "For Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and the one who speaks evil of father or mother, let him be put to death." Matthew 15:4 says much the same. "For God commanded, saying, honor your father and your mother, and the one who speaks evil of father or mother, let him die the death." Those are found in Exodus 20:12, the Ten Commandments. Exodus 21:17, Leviticus 29, and Deuteronomy 5:16. You can read those. But it's said right here. What did Jesus mean by that? Why did he quote that? Matthew 15:5. "But you say, whoever shall say to father or mother, what benefit you might receive from me is being given as a gift to the temple. He is not at all obligated to honor his father or his mother." Say what? Let's read what Mark says about that. Mark 7, verse 11. But you say, if a man shall say to his father or mother, whatever benefit you might receive from me is korban. Have I said that right? Korban is that thing. It's an offering that's set aside as a gift for God. He is not obligated to help his parents. And you excuse him for doing anything for his father or his mother. What's Jesus talking about here? The Pharisees and scribes he's talking to know exactly what he's talking about, but do we know what he's talking about?
Like you said, they put their traditions before the scripture. The scripture says, honor your mother and father. And they say, honor your mother and father, unless their tradition, unless it gets away of their tradition. Like it says here, but you say that if anybody declares what you meant, then you tell your father and mother is korban, that is devoted to God, then you no longer have to honor your mother and father if it's for the church instead. Like it's like for their tradition instead.
Mm-hmm.
So suddenly the scripture isn't important.
Their tradition usurps the scripture, yes, of course.
Yeah.
Jesus is pointing this out, specifically this korban, right? What was going on here is, there were many instances where people had mother and father that were in, you know, they needed help. Poor or whatever, they, you know, needed some help somewhere or another that financially it would help them, right? Because there's talking about money here. And yet, people were giving this money to the temple as this gift called korban, instead of helping their parents. So they were dishonoring their parents by not helping their parents when they ought to be helping them. And the Jewish leadership was giving these people an excuse, a free pass, saying, you're not transgressing that fifth commandment at all, because it's more important for you to give that money to the temple, which where would that money go? Did God take that money up to the, you know? Who had that money then?
Pharisees.
They had that money. Because they were taking that money, and then they could now use that money for whatever they wanted. Oh, it's okay to trample on the fifth commandment, because they could use the excuse, well, you're giving that money to God. When in reality, that money was going to them for their own purposes, wasn't it? Jesus called them out on that.
What are we doing today to our mothers and fathers?
Oh, I know. Yeah.
They're being left in old folks' homes.
Yep.
Some of their recorded treatment in those homes, year after year, you always hear it.
A lot of them don't even have visit.
They don't get visitation.
No.
My son's wife has worked in those kind of places. That's very sad.
Yep. Very lonely. What did people do in olden times when their mother and father grew old?
They would take them in their own home.
Yes, they would.
My wife's family has done.
They would take them into their own home and they would care for them until they died.
Some cultures still do that to this day.
Yes, they do. What do we do today?
Yeah.
We plop them in an old folks home and we leave them there and we don't even visit them.
Sometimes they have Alzheimer's. I don't know their circumstances there.
It doesn't matter the circumstances. Sometimes you need professional help.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Sometimes you need professional help in a matter.
Yeah.
But when we just abandon them.
Sure, forget.
Abandoning your mother and father, especially in their old age when they need you the most, you're breaking that fifth commandment.
But like the Pharisees, it's almost, in a similar way, but loosely, it's almost like we've forgotten or negated the full guilt of our responsibilities. Because yep. Society says, well, we have institutions for them and our tax dollars pays for their care. And
there's always excuses. It's just excuses, because you don't want the responsibility. You don't want to be burdened with having to look after.
Yeah. But I think it's part of just one of the elements that's going to visit upon us a time of trouble, you know, Jacob's trouble. It's just one of those things. That
absolutely
doing,
it is.
You know?
Absolutely it is. Absolutely it is. I mean, it's all cumulative. It's all cumulative. Mark 7, verse 13. Let's go back to 12 here. And you excuse him from doing anything for his father or his mother, nullifying the authority of the word of God by your tradition, which you have passed down. And you practice many traditions such as this. Many traditions such as this. Matthew 15:6, and you have made void the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition. Now let's review this a little bit. This is what their traditions do to the word of God. So says Jesus. Mark 7, verse 7, teaching the doctrines of men. Verse 8, leaving the commandments of God. Verse 9, rejecting the commandment of God. Verse 13, nullifying the authority of the word of God. That's what the traditions have done. And that's what modern day church traditions also do. Wow. That's another wow moment. Remember, these people were constantly following Jesus around, accusing him, trying to discredit him, and ultimately wanted to kill him. And this is how Jesus deals with them. Boldly. Calling them out, which of course would further inflame and provoke these people. You can see how it would all wind up in the end and how Christ was killed. It's very easy to understand how that would come about. People today still wonder, how on earth could they possibly have killed the Son of God? It's not that hard to see. If someone is constantly in your face calling you out for the wrong you do, and they're rightly doing so, would you take offense to that, or would you change and repent? What would you do? What would most people do? What do most people do today? Do they repent and change when they know the wrong of what they do? Or do they hold fast to their own and defend it? Yes, some people repent and change.
The major factor is what?
We think we're right when we do the things we do. How could you say I'm wrong? I'm doing nothing wrong. That's our attitude. We never stop and think, well, hang on, why is this person saying that?
But where does that come from?
Where is your heart?
Yeah, it's just from this.
Where is your heart? There's two spirits.
Human nature, you know?
There's two spirits.
Yeah, you're not using the Spirit of God to use you to... for your thoughts to follow.
No.
You're thinking
you're being worldly. Led by the carnal nature. It's being inflamed by the demonic spirit.
Yeah.
You do not have a pure heart. You don't have a heart that's searching for God. Your heart is far from him. That's what David used to expound upon in the Psalms.
But it's the same thing when people clamor and jockey for position.
Mm-hmm.
This corporate structure, this hierarchical rule from the top down thing. And yet, what keeps coming to mind when the carnal nature tries to come forward in me at work and anywhere I go is, he who is a servant among you will be the greatest. It won't be that way with you.
Nope.
And that can only come by having the Spirit. There's only one way.
There is only one way.
The Pharisees didn't have the Spirit.
No, they didn't.
Well, not only having the Spirit, but letting this, yeah. our carnal nature, even if we are baptized, is always first to react. It's letting the Spirit lead rather than how we feel, you know, our initial reaction.
And my dad says, getting out of the way.
Yeah. The carnal nature will always fight
yeah.
to make the reaction, not necessarily first. That is what you have to change. Make sure that the spiritual nature, God's spiritual nature, reacts before your carnal nature does.
Like Job reacted when his automatic reaction wasn't, what the heck? And then, yeah. hang on a second, it was right away, he's, okay.
Yeah.
He led by the Spirit.
Yes, he was.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the struggle that we have on a daily basis, is when we're confronted with, you know, carnal choices, do you make the spiritual choice? You know, it's hard. It is. That's why I suggest something like this. Makes it easier.
I do read daily.
Good.
I just didn't feel compelled to answer.
Good.
But I do think it's absolutely necessary.
It is necessary. It's very necessary, and you won't realize the necessity and the benefit until you actually do it yourself. Once you engage in it, you do it yourself, and it becomes a daily thing, and it becomes part of your life on a regular basis, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about.
It's spiritual food.
It's spiritual food, yes. But I can't explain it further. You have to experience it.
Do and do.
Right? It's like looking at that just beautiful dish, just a savory dish, and you wonder, oh, man. You'll never understand how it tastes until you actually taste it. You won't. No. The same with daily Bible reading. You won't understand and totally get it unless you actually do it. So I urge you, everybody, I urge you to do so. In any form, that's the way I do it. Right? And it works well for me, actually. Like, I really enjoy it that way. Matthew 15, verse 7. Hypocrites, again he calls them hypocrites. Isaiah has prophesied well concerning you, saying, this people draw near to me with their mouths and with their lips. They honor me, but their hearts are far away from me. But they worship me in vain, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. And after calling the multitude to him, he said to them, hear and understand. That which goes into the mouth does not defile the man, but that which comes out of his mouth, this defiles the man. Mark 7, verse 14. And after calling all the multitude to him, he said to them, hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing that enters into a man from outside which is able to defile him, but the things that come out from within him, those are the things which defile a man. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. What does he mean by that? What does he mean by that? Before I answer that then, I will tell you what modern Christianity thinks about that. They think that this is proof text for doing away with clean and unclean meats. Yes, they do. They think it's proof text for doing away with clean and unclean meats. And Christ was using this comparison of ceremonially clean things, and you had washing this and washing that. I mean, there's no point in that. There's also going to be no point in this clean and unclean meat things anymore, because I'm going to do away with that. All you have to do is believe on me. This is what they believe, that this is. This is the proof text for that. That's not a proof text for this at all. We already had our discussion about what this was. What is true personal holiness? Where does it come from? From within. Can you get true personal holiness from without? This is the comparison Christ was making. You cannot get holiness by making sure that you are ceremonially clean by washing yourself before you eat. You cannot stay clean inwardly by anything that's outward. And it doesn't matter what you take in from outside. It's not going to change anything. So you can see how they can get on this thinking that, well, I guess it wouldn't matter then if I ate a pig or ate some bacon, because it's not going to make me unclean. You can understand their thinking on that, right? Eating bacon has got nothing to do with righteousness, personal holiness. It's got nothing to do with it. True holiness comes from within. It comes from your heart, your mind, your attitude towards God and your fellow man. Personal holiness can never come from outward show. Outward show is a deception. Repentance is necessary. And you can only repent by having a changed heart. Make yourself right with God. Ask for forgiveness. Do what is right. Practice righteousness daily. Increase, strengthen, and grow your faith. And become a child of God. Not permission to eat bacon.
What happens when somebody comes into the church here and they're new? What do we preach to them? What do we tell them about pork?
Same thing we just talked about now.
Because I've been asked about why you don't eat pork. And I give them the biblical, truthful answer.
Yep.
As a result of what happened with Paul, this Pharisaical group of converts that came from Jerusalem, the debate was decided that if you were born and raised that way, it wouldn't be a mitigating factor for you to have salvation. But if you felt that you were covenantally bound, then you should not do it, because then you would be sinning. Can you
Cleaning and unclean meats, the purpose for that, from the beginning, we have a hard time as human beings with our human minds understanding the mind of God. We have a hard time understanding between right and wrong, from sin and righteousness. Hard time. We need physical representations to be able to use as comparisons, things that we can see and touch, understand on a physical level. Unclean meat is looked upon as a type of sin. Clean meat is looked upon as a type of righteousness.
done actually research into the meats that we were told not, and the foods we weren't allowed to eat. And every single food that we were told not to eat is actually, in fact, dirty.
Unhealthy for you too, yes.
Every single one.
Yep.
Well, we're talking about scripture.
No, I know. I'm asking.
We're talking about what this book says.
Yep.
Is that relevant though?
It is relevant because God knows what is healthy for you and what is not healthy for you.
Like I understand if there is, of course, something else deeper behind it, but it is interesting to know that those are in fact bad for your body.
Yes, that is a fact. Yeah. And God knows better than us what is good for our bodies and what is bad for our bodies. And it's no coincidence that he pointed out that these unclean things are unclean.
Because
they are not good for your body, but that was not the intent.
No, I'm thinking because we were originally, you know, Adam and Eve ate fruit, and there was no really. So as far as we know, there was no meat in their diet. But I could be wrong. Like just because it doesn't say it doesn't mean there wasn't.
No
proof that.
Exactly. Yeah. But if that were the case, perhaps you know, if you're gonna eat meat, you know, I'm not gonna.
Okay.
Well, there was research done years ago. Several books that's released by different worldwide Church of God movements starting with the little one. There's principles for health and living. Strong examples, not getting into the doctrine of clean and unclean, was Daniel. When he said to his captors, just feed me and my guys vegetables and water, and within 10 days, you'll see a difference. So that to me is kind of the act of someone who is highly esteemed by God, and he's followed some kind of physical principle. But getting back to this,
talk louder.
Oh, sorry. Getting back to this, believe and unbelief, I don't need more. I feel that I'm covenantally bound.
So you are.
I don't need it, right? But I'm not going to judge someone who, I have a Greek friend who would like to come to church, but who was raised being poor. And he asked me about this question. I'm not going to beat him over the head with the food issue when there's so much more spiritual things that he's discovering that he's starting to, you know, to get into. You know, I believe he's being called. But he asked me, I said that this was the consensus that happened in the New Testament when Paul was calling the Gentiles. This was the result of their judgment when the elders met in Jerusalem. That there was more emphasis on not eating food sacrificed to elders or idols. But if you were covenantally bound or felt you were by not eating pork, then don't eat it because you will be sinning. If you were a Gentile, however, and that's what the whole picture was, these Pharisaical types were trying to make him be circumcised. They were trying to make him stop eating pork. They wanted to Judaize them. You know what I'm saying? And the decision that I understand from Scripture was that they had other emphasis that was more important than on what they put in their bodies. Being that there was a culture in how they were raised to begin with, they weren't covenantally bound by the old covenant.
Circumcision or non-circumcision is a different issue too.
No, but they were held in the same light. Unclean food and circumcision. And that's what they were beating these new converts up with. Something I don't like. I don't like a spiritual bully.
No.
So what's your take on those scriptures and what was ruled in Jerusalem at the time when Paul was facing this adversity? What do you feel of it?
That they declared it was okay to eat pork?
No. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that if you're a Gentile and you were raised this way, what I'm understanding from Scripture is that you're not sinning when you're doing so because you're not covenantally bound, nor have you ever been, nor has your forefather, just as much as you weren't covenantally bound to be circumcised.
No, circumcision was changed to the circumcision of the heart through baptism, accepting Christ. Eating clean and unclean meats was never done away with.
So then what does the Scripture mean when it says that? When it differentiates between those that are covenantally bound and those that are not.
When it's talking about the food that was sacrificed to idols. Mm-hmm. Yes. Don't eat that. If you know that that's what it was. But it's talking about clean foods, not unclean foods. But food that was sacrificed to an idol or not sacrificed to an idol. It never gave permission to eat unclean food.
So all of those new converts that were Greek that always had some sausage for breakfast suddenly had to stop eating that sausage for breakfast. And they had to be like a Jew and not eat pork. So that one, I've still got questions.
Pretty much.
Personal questions on that.
Well, it's just like a Sunday keeper who's always kept the Sabbath on Sunday. Now
It's not like that at all. We're dealing with an instituted, God-worded day of worship as opposed to what you're putting in your face for sustenance. Those are just apples and oranges. But I will read into it further.
No, it's quite in depth. The only thing that you're not covenantly bound to do as a new Gentile convert was to become physically circumcised. But you are circumcised when you were baptized. It's called the circumcision of the heart now. Right? But you can't start eating unclean meats.
Well, our baptism signified our death. Circumcision of the heart comes with practicing what you now have, this paracletos, this spirit.
Yes.
And it changes your heart and it transforms your
heart. Sure it does.
But that's a journey. It doesn't happen instantly at baptism. That's the beginning. But at baptism, more importantly to me, it institutes our death in this world and our death to the carnal nature, doesn't it?
Nope. Christ said, not one dot, not one tittle, not one stroke of a pen will any way, shape, or form disappear from the law until all is fulfilled. Mm-hmm. Circumcision was not done away with, just the physical form of it was done away with. Circumcision was done still spiritually when you're baptized, and it's called the circumcision of the heart. Not one dot, not one tittle, not one stroke of a pen is changed and gone away from the law until all is fulfilled, including clean and unclean meats.
Okay. Well, we still need clarification on what was ruled at that point.
That was. That was.
But the circumcising of the heart at baptism, where's the scripture for that?
Oh, it's there. It's in here.
Okay.
There's lots of proof in there.
What I understood when I was baptized was I was dead to that carnal nature, and I was beginning a
You don't recall circumcision of the heart scripture?
Pardon?
You don't recall circumcision of the heart scripture?
Of course I do.
Yes.
Yeah, when Christ told him, and Stephen told him, your hearts aren't circumcised.
Yeah, and literally when you are baptized, it is a circumcision of the heart. That's in there.
Okay, I'll find it.
That is there. Well, Paul teaches that. You know, we've gone through that before. I can't remember which where it is, but it is there. Right?
My whole point is if there's new people that are coming in.
If new people are coming in and they're eating pork, my duty is to teach them this. And not one dot, one tittle, one stroke of a pen is changed from that until all is fulfilled. Their obligation is to take that information and hopefully make the right decisions with it. It is not my place to force anybody to do anything. Not at all. And it's not my place to make anyone forcefully do anything, or to make them constantly feel guilty about it.
Yeah.
Right? If they're doing something that's worse, like they're engaged in what that fellow in Corinthians was doing, sleeping with his father's wife,
that's different.
I have to stand up to that. Or if someone's in here and they're starting to speak heresies, and they're speaking things that don't belong in here, I have to stand up to that. If they're doing, we have to do that. If they're doing something like eating unclean meat, that's a matter between them and God.
But that's what I'm saying here. To me, it's like that.
It's a matter between them and God. It does not mean that it is okay for them to do so, mm-hmm. and that scripturally it is okay to do so. No, it is not.
I didn't say that. I said I got to look into that a little deeper on what was ruled.
I have.
Well, you have.
Not one dot, not one tittle, not one stroke of a pen is gone and done away with the law, including
the Ten Commandments.
Circumcision.
Yeah, but he was talking about the Ten Commandments.
All.
But that physical law that was a list as long as this.
Yes, and culturally, if we were still culturally there,
so why would
like saying, let's say a blue tassel, or a blue thread in a tassel, right? Why don't we wear tassels with blue threads in them? Because culturally, we don't wear those clothing with tassels in them. Culturally, at that time, they wore those things to outwardly show people, I am a commandment keeper. I am a member of Israel, and I am a commandment keeper. That is a sign of that. All right? Culturally, we don't do that anymore. Right? If you wore clothing like that and it was culturally what you did, then yes, we would do that. But that doesn't mean that law is gone, but the culture was different at the time. You know? Anyway, we digress. We're almost done here.
Well, I thought you were done, sorry.
No. Matthew 15, verse 12. Then his disciples came to him and said, "Do you realize that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this saying?" No kidding. But he answered and said, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted shall be rooted up." Absolutely. If you have not been planted by the Father himself, it will be rooted up. "Leave them alone. They are blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the pit." Then Peter answered and said to him, "Explain this parable to us." But Jesus said to him, "Are you also still without understanding?" Mark 7:17. "Now when he went into a house away from the multitude, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. And he said to them, 'Are you likewise without understanding?' Don't you perceive that anything that enters into a man from outside is not able to defile him? For it does not enter into his heart, but into his belly, and then passes out into the sewer, purging all foods. And he said, that which springs from within a man, that defiles the man. For from within, out of the hearts of men, go forth evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, guile, licentiousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evils go forth from without, and these defile a man. For it does not enter into his heart, but into his belly, and then passes out into the sewer, purging all foods. Hang on, let me say this. If you ate pork unintentionally, I have, it was in a burger once, and I ate it.
Bacon.
It was there. Was I defiled because no. Pork now entered my body? No,
right.
Because the digestion purges it from you. Your body will purge it from you. It doesn't defile you. This saying, purging all foods, does not mean pork is now clean and good for you to eat.
I add to that, just for laughing matter, the New International Version here, it says, for it doesn't go into their heart, but into their stomach, and then out of the body. And then in brackets, it's added in saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean.
Absolutely not. But this is proof text. This is proof text that they use to say that yes, it's okay to eat.
But it actually says it in our version.
Yeah, I know it does.
It's so sad.
But this thing, don't worry about something that enters into your body from without, because it can't defile you. It's what comes from within. If you eat that kind of stuff unknowingly, it's not going to defile you. Just like if you didn't wash your hands before you ate it, it's not going to defile you. You've got it all wrong, you hypocrites. You got it all wrong. Jesus did not declare those things clean, by the way. It's just, you cannot be defiled by eating with dirty hands. No, and you can't be defiled if that kind of stuff enters your body. If you did it willingly, against God, yes, it would, because that is coming from within. That you're openly defiling God, like those guys that went and picked up sticks on the Sabbath day, collecting firewood. You know, it wasn't because, well, it was just a minor little thing, picking up this piece of wood, you know. It's because they were openly defiling God, or defying God. Openly defying God. I'm going to do it anyway. I don't care what you say. That is why that was such a big offense.
The biggest things for us too is what defiles us is when we leave our minds unchained.
Yes.
Not eating.
No.
You know, unintentionally.
No.
Goes back to where is your heart?
Yeah.
The type of food, I mean, that's nothing. Clean and unclean meats was meant to teach us something. It was meant to teach us something. It was meant to teach us about sin and about righteousness, about the way of God and the way of the world. And we need examples like that. And there's no way that you can go from something that pictures sin and the way of the world now being okay. No, absolutely not. The way of God is cleanliness, non-defilement, righteousness, truth, love, sin. No, it's the opposite. Unclean foods has always been pictured as sin. That can't possibly be good again. Can't.
God doesn't
cannot.
Change.
Matthew 15, verse 17. Do not perceive that everything that enters the mouth goes into the belly and is expelled into the sewer? Or do you not perceive that everything that enters the mouth goes into the belly and is expelled into the sewer. Yeah, of course it does. But the things that go forth from the mouth come out of the heart, and these defile the man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, and blasphemies. These things are the things that defile man. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile a man. Doesn't matter what you do ceremonially or what enters the body, if it's by accident, you know, it's the heart. That was good. We got a little fired up here, didn't we?
Yes, we did.